Amen, guys. Well, let's go to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13.
Let's go, Cesar.
In verse 18. Jesus has just finished explaining this parable about a farmer who sows out the seeds and it lands on four different soils. And then he explains it in verse 18. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and doesn't understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The one who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke him, they become unfruitful. Verse 23. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word, understands it, and this is the one who produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. Right here we have the parable from Jesus that the message is the seed and it's thrown to different types of places. You see, sometimes we want to seek the right message instead of being the right soil to receive any message from the Word of God. You know, for us, we need to understand this isn't our church. This is Jesus' church. This isn't our people. It's God's people. So we shouldn't be swayed on what we preach because this is God's Word and God's church. Because at the end of the day, look at the person in your left and to your right, and they're not going to be there on Judgment Day. It's going to be you and God, and the purpose of the church is to come together and be excited about being equipped to know God the way He wants us to. Amen? Amen. Today, the question is not, is the message going to be good? Right. Sometimes we have that. I wonder what the message is going to be about. Is it going to be good? I mean, it was his birthday. Did he really spend time working on it? But if we focus so much on the seed that's being thrown out, instead of I want to be the good soil, no matter what comes from the Word of God, I want to accept it, retain it, so I can multiply to be the disciple God wants me to be. The title of this morning's lesson is Every Disciple Multiplies. Every Disciple Multiplies. You know, first, I want us to just be commended by your sacrifices, because I know we weren't gathered together the week after special missions, but with the disciples here in Portland, the few in number gave over $42,000 for special missions. And not just that, God has blessed us in the first 49 weeks. We have had 49 additions after sending disciples to Lagos, Seattle, Los Angeles. And today, we'll be able to see our new brother, Keith, be added to the kingdom of God. So God is moving, but we need to focus individually on the message He wants to give us. Amen? Sometimes we can say, oh man, there's great things happening around the movement, around the church, around the ministry. But we don't go, what is God multiplying in my life? Today, I want to talk about four things that every follower of Jesus multiplies. Let's go to Matthew 25. Matthew 25, we're going to look at the parable of the talents. Some say the parable of the bags of gold, so I just titled my first point, Golden Talents. Every disciple multiplies what? Golden talents. Matthew 25, verse 14. Says again, you see, Jesus wasn't afraid to just repeat himself over and over. If you're a parent, you understand. So Jesus goes, again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one, he gave 5 bags of gold. To another, 2 bags. And to another, 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work, and he gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But The man who had received one bag went off. He dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Let's stop right here. We know that Jesus gives us parables because our hearts are hard, and until we see it visually, we could understand it spiritually. And so this story that he's talking about, it's not really about a real man that went on a real journey. It's talking about God who's entrusted his wealth to his servants. The servant word here in the Greek is a bond servant, meaning someone that voluntarily offers himself as a slave. You see, God cares about your desires. If you look around this room, nobody is forced to be here, as far as I know. You wanted to be here, and that's why you came here. And if you feel forced, that door is open for a reason, so no one says that we lock people inside the room, amen? And so yet, God desires that we worship in truth and in spirit, meaning we want to be here, but we want to know the truth as well. And that's why we have our Bibles open, to figure out what are these talents that God has given us, and how could we use them to multiply them, amen? The man is God who goes on a long journey. Now, what's this long journey? Whenever you have a long time to do something, doesn't it make you feel a little more comfortable when the teacher says, hey, you know what? I'm going to give you a 2-week extension. Oh, yes. I'll work on it in 1 week and 6 days. My mom would leave me at home sometimes and be like, son, I want you to clean up the kitchen, the laundry, do this and fold the clothes and turn off the frijoles in 1 hour. Man, 2 hours later, I just hear that garage open and I'm trying to do everything in 1 minute. And the beans always burn when I'm put in charge of them, amen? But some of us, we're going to act like that when Jesus comes back from his journey. And we're going to be trying to put everything together last minute. But here's the bottom line fact. All of us are going to die in this room. It's just a matter of, is it going to be expected or unexpected? Are you going to die fast or are you going to die slow? Sometimes slow is better because you have time to think. And you have time to gather, am I ready to go? Have I done what I wanted to do? You know, there was a board in New York City that they put on the streets that they said, what's one thing you regret? And everyone filled it up. And almost nothing was about things they have done, but things that they haven't done. And this is a sin in a Christian. Not what they do, but what they don't do. Because this man right here, what did he do with the bags of gold that God gave him? He went and hid it. He didn't do anything with it. And the other two just multiplied what God had given them. And they were just happy. They go, God, you gave me 2? Oh my, I have 4 now. You gave me 5? Now I have 10. The other one comes and says, well, God, you gave me 1, but I went and I hid it. What does that look like in our modern day? Well, the bag of gold, if you look at your footnotes, means about a 20 years of a day laborer's wage. If you put it in our time, it's $1.2 million. God gave him so much. But what does he do? He went off and he hides it. Some of us are in this spot where we're just wanting to be saved. And that's it. God, you've given me the kingdom. You've given me salvation. But I just want to keep it. I don't want to multiply it. I just want to keep it because it's easier. Let's see what happens to this man. Verse 19. You guys with me here? Verse 19. What is the real problem with this guy? Let's look so that it won't be our problem. Amen? Verse 19. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I've gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share in your master's happiness. The man with the 2 bags of gold also came. See, you've entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share in your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you're a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out, and I hid your gold in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you. His master replied, I understand. You were afraid. No. Just making sure we're following along in the scriptures, amen? His master replied, you wicked and lazy servants. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. Take the bag of gold from him. Give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside in the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And that's how Jesus closes his sermon. Amen? It doesn't always have to be in an inspiring way. What do we see here? There are people who are in need to settle accounts. You know, we never know when we're going to go, and that's why I love songs like that. Gotta be ready when he calls my name. Yeah. Sometimes we think we're doing God a favor by us being ready. Who looks happier here? God, you gave me 5? I got 5 more! Or, God, I know you're a hard man. I was afraid, and so I just went off and I hit it. Who seems more fired up in life?
Right.
Who's living life to the full here?
Come on.
The person who knows God. I put before you, if you're not multiplying what God has given you, it comes down to your perception of God. Because this man says, God, you're a hard man. This is what we do when we make decisions out of fear. We start creating our own God. Is God really a hard man? He even tells him, Lord, you expect me to do things that you're not helping me out with. You want me to go and gather stuff that you've not even scattered seeds in. How does this look for us? Well, for us, I think of inventing ways of doing evil like the world does. In the kingdom, God expects us to invent ways of doing good. You see, what we do in the church here, it's not just religious customs that we do. Go to church. Do Bible studies with people. No, we sit down. We get to know them. We don't just go through the first principles as Bible studies. We're getting in that person's heart, in that person's life. And what does it take? An investment. That you don't even know you might get anything back in return on this earth.
Right.
But he says, you should have just put my money with some security, with some bankers, so that it could be invested. You should have just thought of something.
Right.
You know, the other 2 and 5, how did they multiply their talents? It doesn't say. Because there's many ways that God will multiply your talents. But the hardest, do you want to? You know, yesterday was so encouraging. We went on a birthday breakfast that I was super surprised at. I always get to you, you know? But afterwards, we were walking out, and all of a sudden, this woman grabs somebody's wallet and starts running. And you just hear the man chasing him going, she stole my wallet! And we go, and they grab her, they put her down, and then after like 10, 15 minutes, me, my wife, and George, Valeria, we're walking down, and we see her getting caught, and she's down on the floor in tears going, I'm sorry, I was just desperate. I don't know what to do. I just moved here. I have nothing. You just go, look at people in the world, how desperate they get. That leads them to doing things and then start inventing ways of doing evil. I guarantee you, this woman didn't grow up wishing she could grow up to steal someone's wallet. People grow up and do things because they get desperate. But God in the kingdom expects us to take what he has given us and to get desperate about doing what is good with it. You know, I appreciate our brother Nick Borderi who came with us last week. And Nick Borderi is someone who, he'll come and he's not just going to have fun and fellowship. He's going to get down to business. He gets with me, he starts discipling me. He gets with Fernando, he starts discipling him. He gets with George, he gets discipling. I mean, a week after Nick Borderi left, I just hear George, yeah, bro, he discipled me on this. Fernando goes, yeah, he talked to me about this. And then he left us with something incredible called the New Membership Portland Packet, which is 17 pages filled with how to keep the young Christians growing in the faith and how to resolve conflict in the church, the whole calendar for next year, the leaders in the church to understand them. I mean, how many of us didn't understand missions or leadership or world sectors till months out? I'll never forget, we had the tagging session and all the new Christians were there tagging. Yeah, special missions, the twins were there. And then like a month later, we just go, all right, guys, we got to talk about special missions. I go, what's special missions? You've been screaming and collecting money. And then we explain it, but how many of us if we could just think, everything God has given you, how could you use it to glorify God? I want you to write down one talent. That means you go, oh, I don't know if I could use that talent. God will multiply it. But you got to invent ways of doing good. Our brother, our new brother, Jose, who got baptized last week, he plays the guitar. What did we tell him, bro? Christmas service? We want to sing Feliz Navidad, amen? So I thought I'd announce that to put a little more pressure on him to memorize it. But if he doesn't, let's have mercy on him, amen? Yeah, I appreciate Alessia. She has some gifts with organization. And so we say, you know, she's going to be our new church assistant for the Portland church here. I just gave her one dude. I said, you're in charge of color coding the calendar. You have till Monday. The next day, she's like, boom, here it is. Whoa, that would have taken me weeks. But what talent has God given you that he wants to multiply? You know, don't you guys love Rich Noches' song leading? Yeah. But I tell you, when he first got into the kingdom, he could barely say one word. I mean, he was the most quiet to himself. I'll never forget, I picked him up one time and I was playing some Shakira in the car. The Waka Waka song. And he starts dancing a little bit. I go, man, this guy's getting some life into him. And he starts singing Waka Waka. And next thing you know, bro, you have a talent and he's going to be a song leader. And God used it to bless him to have incredible skills. Amen. What's the one talent that God wants to multiply in your life? Write down this scripture, Romans 12, 3-7. And those are all the gifts that God gives us as disciples to the church. And in the beginning, you'll notice it says, you need to have sober judgment. Amen? That means don't think you have a gift when you don't. You have to figure out God's will. I know one of my mistakes is I thought I had the gift of song leading. The only song leading I could do is my wife next to me. But think of the gift that God wants to multiply in your life. And don't have the wrong perception of God. This man right here, he's going, God, you're just a hard man. How many times do we do that? We go, God, I know you expect complete obedience to your scriptures, but you've given me a hard situation to do that in. What do we call God right there? A powerless God. Right. Kind of like 2 Timothy 3 talks about. You have a form of godliness, but you deny its power. You go to church, you read your Bible, but it's not changing your life. We say, God, I know you want us to bear much fruit. You want us to go gather the harvest, but you don't put anybody open in my path. What do we say? God, you're a liar. Why don't we just call it like it is? We go, God, you're a liar. You said that I'm going to bear much fruit. I don't believe you. Because the people in my work are not open, I've already invited them. So I'm gonna keep my salvation hidden and only share when someone else brings it up. You ever have that? I'm a disciple, I talk about God when someone else talks about God. In this day and age, when does someone just talk about God? When we go, God, I know you expect me to make disciples of all nations, but when I look at the plan and I look at my church, I don't know if we can do it. We call God an impossible God. We go, God, I know you want me to love God with all my heart, but I'm afraid of what that's going to do to my friendships, to my family, to my job. I mean, they want me to get Sunday mornings off to come to church. I might get fired. God, you want me to love you with all my heart, but yet you have me in a rough situation. You're just calling God an unfaithful God. You see, people think it's hard to be a disciple sometimes. And you know what I say? It's hard not to be a disciple. You live in the kingdom for weeks, months, years. The moment you think being a disciple is hard is the moment you got ungrateful and forgot how awesome it is to dwell in God's kingdom. How beautiful it was. You forgot how hard it was in the world with your sin that you were enslaved to. That you try to put up a front like, I got it together. No, you don't. Because you're doing things that you don't confess to anybody. That's why people say, well, as soon as I started going to this church, I just started struggling. No, you're just now in the battle. You're not fighting the spiritual battle. You go, I don't know, the spiritual battle is going great. Maybe you're just losing it because you're not really fighting it. God wants to multiply our talents, but write down that one thing, that if you invest in it, God will give you 100 times much more. And you know what happens when every disciple multiplies their talents? The church will build itself up in love. And we will look at each other and go, hey, look, I know that's who you are, but that's not who you're going to be. Every disciple changes radically. month after month, year after year. How many of us stepped into the kingdom? We didn't know how to dress. We didn't know how to talk. Maybe we're socially awkward. Maybe we just didn't know how to even keep a rhythm. You know, our first week of, we didn't even know what to do here. And then God bless you. He said, oh, you want to sing? I'm going to give you a little more talent to sing. You want to be outgoing? I mean, here's the bottom line truth. I was not cut out to be a leader the first couple years as a disciple.
Come on, bro.
I'll never forget, you know, they announced that we're going to lead the Palm Springs sector. I went up to my leader. I said, bro, it'd be incredible if I could lead it. He says, let me talk to Kip. Kip says, now, Cesar is just in the back. He's never even shared good news. He's been coming to staff for 1 year. I don't think he can do it. That's my encouragement that I got as I rose to leadership. We say, amen. If it's not God's will, I got to have sober judgment. But I got to get that talent. I'm not talking about talent, skillful talent. I'm talking about the heart to be able to, whatever God gives me, I'm going to multiply it. And then you look around this room and he multiplies our talents. What's that going to lead to? Let's look in Luke 17. My second point is every disciple multiplies their faith. Luke 17. You guys with me here? Luke 17, verse 1. Every disciple needs to multiply their faith. Why? Why do we need faith as a disciple? You know, in the religious world, you don't need a lot of faith to be religious. You need a lot of religiosity to be religious. When you're in the battle and you need faith to overcome your sin, you need faith to get in people's lives, you need faith to preach the word. And so look at what Jesus gives them here. He gives them some hardline teachings, and then look at the disciples' response. Verse 1. Jesus said to his disciples, isn't that awesome? He spoke to his disciples then, and he's still speaking to his disciples now. Amen? Things that cause people to stumble are bound to come. But woe to them through whom they come through. It will be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. So watch yourselves. If your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. And if they repent, forgive them. Even if they sin against you 7 times in 1 day. That ever happened to you? Then 7 times come back and say, I repent. You must forgive them. The apostle said to the Lord, "Whoo! Increase our faith." He replied, "Well, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you." Wow. What do we learn here, guys? First of all, sin is bound to come. Sin is going to enter your brother or your sister. You will be sinned against. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
Because I think we come into the kingdom and everything's so incredible, we forget people will mess up. And that's okay. Because if 7 times they mess up and 7 times they want to repent, guess how many times you have to forgive them? 7 times. And the disciples are like, whoa, Jesus, increase our faith. I mean, that is a hard teaching. I thought there was a limit on forgiveness. You know, sometimes people, even in the light of our former movement and what happened to it, people go, I wonder if the same sins are going to happen again. And we almost live in a suspicious environment of, uh-oh, this might, I see this. This is going to lead somewhere where I know where it's going to lead. This is the difference. I could just soften and clear everyone's minds of that. The same sins are going to happen. Because from the first book in the Bible to the last, we see disciples that lose heart. We see disciples that fall short. But what's the difference in Jesus' church? That there is an environment of confession, repentance, and forgiveness. That we can say, brother, you messed up in this way. Brother, I repent. Thank you for that rebuke. And you know what? I forgive you. You guys okay with that right there, those 3 steps?
Yeah.
Brother, you messed up. Here is a rebuke. Thank you so much. I repent. And you know what? I forgive you. And there is mercy. And I don't think God is looking down at the Portland church going, I just want them to get it straight. I want them to, their relationships to be on point, to never mess up with each other. That's not God. God's looking down going, oh baby, I'm actually going to put this one to the test. This person's going to become weak so this brother could extend his arms of love. Because God even puts the weak in place in the church. And what's our job as disciples? To strengthen the weak. But then there's going to be more weak. And if we have an environment of not being able to take care of the weak, what's going to happen? We then won't be able to see God bless us with more fruit because really, a lot of us are weak in a lot of areas. And so we're all weak in some ways. And if you want to learn more about this, Fernando's going to do a lesson on leaders meeting. Amen. What do we see here? Jesus, after he says, increase our faith, he says, look, if you just have a small mustard seed of faith, you could look at this mulberry tree. And I did a lot of commentary searching. You ever do a lot of commentary searching and be disappointed on how little commentary there is about it? Like, this just makes no sense. Well, all it came down to is that mulberry trees have some of the thickest roots because they're really wide, but they're really short. And only in the book of Luke, you see him distinguishing the trees like sycamore, fig tree, mulberry tree, because he was a doctor and all these trees were used for healing. And so he looks at this mulberry tree and he says, this mulberry tree right here, I'm over here thinking like, what meaning is this? Well, it just happened to be there. So Jesus just talked about the mulberry tree that was in front of him. He looks at this mulberry tree, this could be uprooted. Nothing could make that happen. Not a thunder, not a hurricane, uprooted. And then planted in the seed. What's the symbolism? It's just an impossible thing. It's just so impossible that only God can do it. How am I gonna forgive my brother 7 times? How am I going to repent? How am I going to forgive? Well, he says, you need to be an uprooter of mountains, uprooter of trees. And that's not gonna happen with you alone. It's gonna happen with God multiplying your faith. How are the situations that you're going through in life right now? Is it pushing you to go, oh, I'm afraid, or Lord, increase my faith? Sometimes we think God is putting me through a hard situation for unknown reasons. No, he'll give you those reasons as soon as you have the heart to say, increase my faith. I need my faith to be strengthened here. Every opportunity that comes my way, I gotta believe God. Could you imagine if all of us in this room, guys, we took the word of God and we said, I believe it with all my heart. And whatever God tells me, I will believe it. You guys seen the license plate that says, God says it, I believe it, that settles it. Well, we have to switch it up a little bit because it's God says it, that settles it, whether I believe it or not. You see, what are we doing here, guys? We're not making up grace. We're not making up discipleship. We are just preaching to light what's already been there. We're preaching to light the grace that has been given to us since the beginning of time. That's why God says you could receive grace in vain, meaning you could be forgiven. But then because you're so mopey about being yourself, you're not going to be able to take that grace into effect. God has given you the power to repent. But if we don't preach it to light, no, I want to repent. No, God, increase my faith here. Because all of our situations boil down to, do we really believe God's word? How do you know if you really believe God's word? Do you get surprised? Do you get surprised? Yeah, I appreciate our brother Carlos. You know, last week when Jose was baptized, he shared this. He goes, I went to campus. I said, God, you're going to find someone that I'm going to reach out to and baptize. So he starts sharing his faith, and then God puts him to the test. No, 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 no. So he goes home, discouraged, and cries. No, that didn't happen. He stays on campus and says, God, I'm surprised. I asked you for something. I'm surprised you're not giving it to me. I'm going to keep trying with perseverance. Reaches out to a couple of girls. They say no. And then guess what happens? His friend Jose comes up to him. He said, bro, what are you doing here? Wow. He said, I'm just studying the Bible. Do you want to study the Bible? Yes. Awesome. That's what I was waiting for. Jose says, I thought I was joining a book club. Nope, you're repenting and becoming a disciple. That's what's happening. But I think some of us get surprised when we shouldn't be. God says, the harvest is plentiful. Go and gather the harvest. And then we say, do you want to come to church? Yeah, I'd love to. Oh my gosh! He said yes. Yes. stop doubting God. He says, man, I feel so happy right now. That's how you should be. I feel like this is a special day. No, it's not your birthday. It's special because you're in Jesus. And when you're in Jesus, you should have the, you know, God is in control. I appreciate Sunday mornings because there's always like 10 reasons to be discouraged. Like, so-and-so didn't make it. You know, I had 4 people coming, 2 of them canceled. You know, there's like, they closed, locked the doors on us. You know, didn't have time to make coffee. I mean, there's all kinds of things that come up on Sunday morning. First world problems. But there's so many reasons to be encouraged when you're walking with God. And I beg you guys, whatever situation you're in, take it to increase my faith, Lord. I don't see a reason to need more faith. Get your prayers out there where you start dreaming more, where you want to take a radical change in course in your life, because God's message is not meant to be just read. It's meant to apply. Gandhi lived by his motto, my life is my message. Could someone look at your life and go, wow, that's the message of Jesus right there. This brother walks the walk. I don't even have to do the Bible studies. I know what a disciple looks like because I've seen this person. Not because he's perfect, because he repents when he messes up, because he gets open when he messes up, because he preaches the word and he shares his faith wherever he goes. And when he's feeling a little cowardly, he goes, God, increase my faith. And God will always give you the boldness because he wants to multiply your talents and multiply your faith. Amen? Let's go to 2 Corinthians 10. What happens when our faith is multiplied? 2 Corinthians 10, verse 15. You guys with me here? 2 Corinthians 10, verse 15. It says, neither do we go beyond our limits by boasting of work done by others. Our hope is that as your faith continues to grow. So what happens when our faith continues to grow? You guys ready for this? Yeah. As our faith continues to grow, our sphere of activity among you will greatly expand so that we could preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. Wow. Every time a disciple is added to God's kingdom, he becomes a sphere of activity. Whoa. That means now there's something happening in that person's workforce, in that person's school. That's why we get so excited when someone gets baptized. Because it's not only that person that's going to be blessed, it's all those that he's going to meet. It's all those that he's going to impact. It's all those seeds that are going to be spread. Our sphere of activity in Portland, guys, needs to grow. I was talking to Jason and Mitri a few weeks ago. He says, brother, I remember when Portland was at over 500 disciples. He goes, you couldn't go anywhere and not be reached out to by disciples. Because there's 500 disciples in all Portland with that sphere of activity, spreading love, spreading unity. You know, I was so encouraged. Even last week, I was on a regular day. I went to Best Buy. And who do I see? I didn't even know. Brooke works at Best Buy. And I had to put him on blast. I'm like, hey, Brooke, oh, we go to church together. And no one was surprised. So I go, hey, man, he's sharing his faith, you know? And then I go back home, and I see the workers that are replacing our bus stop. And then I go, babe, you know, Devontae works at one of those bus stop changing places. And then Devontae is changing my bus stop in front of my house. I go, man, this is incredible, just seeing disciples wherever you go. And I go, you know what? This is amazing. Because every single one of you is a sphere of activity. You go, I want a position. I want to do a ministry. No, you are your ministry. Do you believe that? That you could make impact. God wants to make incredible impact to you and through you. I know there's a false teaching out there. You go, well, my gifts is music. So I just encourage the church with my music. Yeah, that could be true, but every disciple shares their faith. You go, well, that's not my gift. My gift is more encouraging. So I just encourage and take sisters out on kingdom dates. Yeah, you should do that. But you should also share your faith. You should also preach the word. You should also contribute. Every disciple has a sphere of activity. And I don't know about you, but I'm always encouraged. I always talk about this. When you search for a Starbucks, why is Starbucks the best place to meet? Well, number one, they have free refills if you have a gold card. But number two, that you see the red dots all over. They've evangelized them. I mean, you know, where are we going to meet Fernando for D time? What do we say? Starbucks. Which one? I don't know, but there's one around your house, I'm sure. When God looks down, and if someone starts praying, God, I want to find you. And guess what happens? There's those red dots that are, well, there's someone right by your house. And I want to share some amazing announcements. If you look at your sheet, the crown of thorns for Portland. You know, we usually pass out the crown of thorns for our plan to evangelize the world, which is totally necessary. But we also need a plan and a reminder of what is our plan to evangelize Portland. Well, if you could see in the front page, Jerusalem, does everybody have one? Well, share with the person that has, raise your hand if you have one. If you have one, raise your hand. Well, just share with your row there. Must have not printed enough. We'll post this. Keisha, Facebook post this, amen?
Yes, I will.
Faithful Facebooker there. This is our plan. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. This was Jesus' plan. The very last words before he went to heaven, he goes, guys, go to Jerusalem, and then go to Judea and Samaria, and then go to the ends of the earth. Did they do that, guys? Oh, yeah. Colossians 1:23 says, every creature under heaven has heard about it. Does this mean that everyone in the world is going to become disciples? No, because we know the road is narrow, and only a few will find it. But everybody has an option. Everyone has that choice. You know, for Fernando, his younger sister in his house about, what's it, 20 years ago, started behaving not so well. So what happens? They send her to Guatemala. That same year, the church is planted in Guatemala, and his sister becomes a disciple that year. How many of us were baptized outside of Portland? Look around this room. Could you see that we're not a community church? This is a worldwide movement of churches. And so if we don't have a global vision, we will not evangelize our local communities. What's Jerusalem for us? It's downtown Portland. Yo, why, bro? Because that's where we all come and meet. Amen? Portland State University is where our main ministry is at. Judea and Samaria, what's that? The places surrounding that we have ministries. Beaverton, Hillsboro, Tigard, Vancouver, and PCC, Sylvania. What's the three steps? Phase one, you guys ready for this?
Yeah.
Get Bible talks in every city in Portland.
Come on.
But it starts with the most influential cities. And these are argumentative. So if you have serious concerns, just talk to me afterwards. But in the green ones is where we already have ministries. The purple ones, we call them remnant groups. It's just disciples live there, but we haven't sent out a ministry there. And I just realized Marion lives in Gresham, so the Gresham is actually supposed to be in purple. Amen? We do have to get disciples in Happy Valley. But what's phase two? Plant churches in the surrounding areas. You know, I was so encouraged even yesterday. George gave me a little birthday gift, and he loves pins. He gets a pin from every campus he goes to, and he gave me this pin right here, which is just the state of Oregon, and it has a little heart, the little Portland heart, and he says, put it on your heart, because in Exodus 28, it says every time the priest needed to make a decision, they put the names of the tribe of Israel on the breast piece, and then they made a decision. I go, man, that's awesome. Every time I make a decision, I'm going to put this on me. And then I thought about it. I said, I make decisions almost every day. I'm going to keep this on me all the time. And so after praying and going, God, what decisions do we want to take? We decided in January, George and Monique are going to gather a team and go to North, which is going to be Portland Community College Cascade. We already have incredible disciples chosen, and there's two more that we haven't told. Just be praying for that. Amen? But it's incredible. University of Portland is up there. There's four college campuses just in that 1 2-mile radius. So now there's going to be a sphere of activity going on in North Portland. If you look at August 2017, our plan is to send a ministry to East Portland. And come January 2018, next year's winter workshop, we're sending the church to Boise, Idaho. So how are we going to do it? Lord, increase our faith. Amen? And it's exciting because I know a lot of us even have family in Idaho, and we got to send a church there. You know, guys, last few days ago, I was talking to my daughter, who now resides in Bakersfield. And she goes, you know, Dad, I miss Kids Kingdom. Because it's just not the same without it. Wow. And I go, well, we'll send a church there to Bakersfield soon.
Come on.
She goes, why don't you just send Fernando and Jackie here now? Of course, their daughters are her best friends. So I go, that's not a bad idea. But do we have that heart for our physical family that we want them to be saved, but that heart towards even these cities? I go, where is Happy Valley at? Where in the world is West Lynn? Our brother Paul lives in Bethany. I go, where is Bethany? It's a very spiritual place. I go, we got to evangelize Bethany. And be praying, because we're praying Paul could start a Bible talk in Bethany soon and very soon. Amen. How is this going to happen, guys? Jesus gives us the plan. Lord, increase our faith. And by that, our sphere of activity will greatly expand. Worship service on Sundays is not what the world thinks. A worship service. Kind of like a, okay, it's 10 a.m. Time to get my worship on. Time to put my suit. Time to get my singing on. And then, boom, I leave. And it's a total different life. Now I'm no longer in worship. What does Romans 12 verse 1 say? Let's turn there. How are we going to increase our sphere of activity? You guys with me here?
Yeah.
Romans 12, verse 1. Says, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters. So is this a suggestion? Now God is really wanting us to be urged here. In the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, His pleasing, and His perfect will. Isn't that incredible right there, guys? How many of us want to know God's will? A lot of us say we want to know God's will, but what's the process of knowing God's will? Because a lot of people will turn on their TV, and how do we know a lot of people do this? Because they become rich off doing this. You let a televangelist say, hey guys, you're going to be prospered, and just say this prayer from your couch. You don't have to go anywhere. Let's make worship easier. Just stay at your home. Oh, you can't get Sunday mornings off? Oh, we have Sunday night services. Oh, you can't get Sunday night services? We have the Tuesday night services. And everything is conformed to your schedule. And then we get boggled when we enter the kingdom. We say, no, the kingdom doesn't work around our schedule. We forge our life. If we're disciples, they're saying, we give up everything. How about just switching things from our life to be adjusted to God's plan? That's not something that just happens, guys. It's a renewing of your mind. What's the pattern of this world? Just numb out. You don't need anything. You don't need anyone. Just listen to your heart. Find a few people that are close to you, and if they accept you for who you are, they're your friends. Now, if they try to change you, they're not your friends. That's the pattern of this world. Find a church that fits you, that you like, that you feel comfortable in, that you like the pastor, that you like the band. God says, no, renew your mind and say, I want to become the sacrifice. Worship is not on Sunday mornings. Worship is every single day. Yeah. And isn't that a little more freeing now? This time here gathered as a family is not just checking off worship service. Now it's gathering with all the other people that worship God in the week. All the other people that are going to help you by how they've messed up. If you've messed up this week, who's messed up this week? It's okay. Now just teach someone else what you learned. Because maybe they already messed up in that way and they could help you. Or maybe they're going to mess up like that next week. If we are going to evangelize Portland and fulfill this crown of thorns, we need to become living sacrifices. To go, in my job, I know some of us have said, I don't like my job. You need to repent and realize that's your worship. Worship is not, I feel good right now because I love this song. I feel good. Good. No, that's not worship. That's just singing to God, which is a command as well. So we need to sing.
Come on.
But worship is, I don't like my job, but you know what? That's my inner flesh saying, I know God has some sphere of activity here.
Yes.
I know he wants me to do something here. In Luke 16, it says that if you love money, it means you hate God. If you're devoted to God, you will despise money. And the word despise in the Greek means to think little or nothing of. That means if I have money, amen. Like it's just think little of it. Even Jesus says money given to you is just a test. Money is given to you for two reasons. To test you and to help you gain friends to make disciples. That's what money is for. To help you be generous. And that does test your heart. I appreciate Paul's contribution. It's a heart. Why are we talking about the heart? Because that's all God wants us to do is give our hearts. And your treasure is where your heart will be also. Sometimes we hear someone talk about money. Oh man, this makes me struggle. And we even like, don't say that. My visitor might feel weird about this church. We're talking about money. No, Jesus talks about money a lot. Because that's the only way to really show where your heart really is. I appreciate Fernando. Who could tell me what Fernando does for a living? Maybe two people, three people. Let's just say he has a cranking job. He's a manager. But why don't we really know what he does exactly? Because he doesn't really talk about it a lot. He's cranking at his job. He'll stay up late for his job. He'll travel for his job because he worships God at his job. And so he's talking about the kingdom. He has money, despises it. He thinks little or nothing of it. If I have money, amen, I'm going to give it to the kingdom. I'll never forget when he joined the new movement, we said, hey, bro, we have special missions in 2 weeks. He says, amen, we'll help with what we can. And because of their sacrifice, the East blew it out 150% that week. A bunch of campus students. And he came, he's out of this business, faith launcher, and he poured his time into his job and then poured his time into his business. But then he started being involved in the kingdom. And he started really living out discipleship and worshiping God every day. And then he saw, you know what? If God gives me something, amen. And if I don't have something, amen to that as well. Because at the end of the day, the only thing that's going to matter is what we take with us to heaven. Yeah. And I know that God says we could take one thing to heaven with us. The people that are disciples. Because at the end of the day, when we look at all the saints gathered around, it's going to be the impact that was created. The people baptized in North Portland, in South Portland, that are just desperately seeking and inventing ways of doing evil. You're inventing ways of doing good to reach out to them and to baptize them and to show them what life is all about. Amen? Amen. Let's go to Luke chapter 8 to close out.
Come on, bro.
Luke chapter 8. God will multiply not just your talents and your faith and your activity. My last point is every disciple multiplies themselves. Luke chapter 8 verse 15. It says the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a crop. No one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed. Instead, they put it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, and nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. Whoever has will be given more, And whoever does not have, even what they think they have, will be taken away from them. Now Jesus' mother and brothers came to see him, but they're not able to get near him because of the crowd. Someone told them, your mother and your brothers are outside and they want to see you, Jesus. He replied, my mother and my brothers are those who hear God's word and put it into practice. God gives us a promise that you will be multiplied 30, 60, 90 times what was sown. How will this happen? This is the simple solution. Hear the word. Amen? Amen, amen, guys?
Amen.
You're hearing the word? Retain it. So don't let today just be a lesson that, oh, I think I enjoyed my 1 hour there. No. Let it be a time where you retain it. You look later at the scriptures and see what else God is trying to show you from it. And you persevere because, yes, it might get tough, but it's a lot tougher to live in the world. He says, persevere and you will multiply. I want to ask you a question. Do you want to multiply your life?
Yes.
Do you want to multiply your heart? Don't say yes. Just take time to think about it. Do you want someone else to be like you? Do you want someone else to follow in your footsteps? Maybe not in the same situation you're in, but you go, man, if they could be in a worse situation, amen. You know what the Bible says? Repentance brings refreshment and leaves no regrets. Do you realize that's the life of a disciple? You should have no regrets. There shouldn't be, oh no, I should have done that. No, I appreciate doing that. Oh, I wish I didn't sin. No, I appreciate that I sinned. Because it helped me to repent and see the grace of God. And now I can help those who struggle with that same very sin. And God's sovereignty leads you to where you are at. Because at the end of the day, your life is where it's at because of the decisions that you have made.
Yeah.
You can't blame it on someone else. You weren't chosen how you were born into the world, but you are chosen where you go. And I'm not talking about eternity only. I'm talking about where you go from this day forward. The challenge, guys, is what are we really multiplying? A family. Jesus preaches this message and goes, you guys are lights to the world. Don't be a light and hide it. Don't put up a light and just put it under the bed. Wouldn't you not be upset at your kids if they just lit up a lamp and then put it under the bed? That's electricity wasted right there. But how much of what God gives us is wasted if we don't multiply it? After preaching this message, Jesus says a simple principle, spiritual family supersedes physical family. He looks at those in a circle and says, amen, my family's outside, but these are my true family. And when your family sees that conviction that you have, guess what happens? What happened with Jesus? Once he died on the cross, his mom and his brothers who would make fun of him ended up becoming disciples because they persevered and produced a crop. You know, guys, what we have here in Portland is incredible. It's a family.
Yeah.
And you need to look around this group and be able to say the same thing. God is going to multiply this small family. And not only that, in Ephesians 3:20, he says, I'm going to give you more than what you ask or imagine. You know, he's going to multiply even what you want. You go, God, I want this. I want to do more than that. What is something you want to see in Portland multiply?
Amen.
What are some of those things right now? I want you, and if you see someone say something you want to, write it down and pray about it. What are some of those things on your heart? For me, it's the church. God wants to multiply the Spanish ministry, the teen ministry, the campus ministry, and the marrieds and singles ministry. Amen. What do you want to see God multiply in Portland this coming year?
Musical talent.
Yeah. It'd be great to have a band, to have a drums, to have a choir. AMS ministry. What else?
CR
ministry. If there's any city in America that needs it, it's Portland. God needs to multiply that. What else do we want to see God multiply?
Deep convictions.
That we could come in here and, yeah, we're a fellowship and we love each other, but we have that serious face that let's be awesome disciples this week.
Jazz.
Amen. AMS ministry.
Just more households.
That landlords get impacted, that the apartments get shared with 10 times.
More song leaders.
More song leaders, AMS.
Shepherding.
Sports ministry.
Yeah.
Shepherding. That God just multiplies our shepherds.
Bible talks within the high schools.
High school Bible talks. One more.
Mercy projects.
Mercy projects, amen. I know one of us that we want is more dating couples. So Craig and Keisha won't be alone here. More finances to hire full-time people. That's not going to happen by us sitting back. It's going to happen by going, Lord, increase our faith. And yes, He will increase your personal talent. He will increase your personal faith. He will increase your personal sphere of activity. So as a church, He multiplies us into the nations and give true joy into this world, like our brother Keith is going to receive this morning. Amen. To God be the glory.